Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsachanu Ramardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagadgurum Atra Upasthite Bhyaha Vidyadvaranya Bhyaha Saprashyam Pranamaha Idanim Samskrita Bhashayam Vaktavimiti Ichchasti Kintu Mlecha Bhashayam Uchyate Cheta Ativa Samichinam Miti Vedmi Kuta Iti Cheta Aneke Samskrita Bhasha Anabhijnaha Api Atra Syuhu Iti Drishtya Ataha Mlecha Bhashayam Ashritya Kinchit Vaktu Kamosmi Kshantavyahayam Jana Friends, I am itching for the last 2 days to say something in this particular audience because the subject is so close to my heart. For the last 50 years, I have tried to churn the ocean of Indology. Unlike Wendy Doniger and other people who are always getting hala hala, etc., I am trying to get ambrosia from the Amrita Manthana or Samudra Manthana. Before we proceed to churn the ocean, first and foremost thing is, what are our objectives? Are we interested in worldly things or are we interested in spirituality, philosophy, etc.? I think most of the pundits in the modern world are at crossroads. They can neither give up the facilities of the physical world, nor they can be totally in the spiritual world. Am I right or wrong? And most of the pundits whom I have seen who speak about philosophy, they are too early many a times. So from that point of view, we have to clear two important things. When we are churning the ocean of Indology, are we interested in worldly things? Or are we interested in spiritual things? These two things have to be clarified first. From my point of view, I am interested in both. Because when you think of your own body, it is a combination of Prakriti, Purusha and also Paramatma. That's why in Ayurveda we say, Shadvimshakaha Purushaha. 25 Prakriti Tattvas are there in our body and also the Jivatma is there, and in addition to that, philosophers, Vedantins say there is Paramatma also. Let us accept it as the 27. So, when you are thinking of doing some research work in the field of Indology, you can neither give up the Prakriti Mandala, nor you can give up the Adhyatma Kshetra. So, from that point of view, we should be able to do research work in both the fields. That's what I am seriously thinking. I think there is one particular scholar present here who did research work on Vaisheshika philosophy, particularly from the point of view of physics. Am I right? So she is here. And Dr. C.S.R. Prabhu has written a book on Vaisheshika philosophy, and he says Vaisheshika physics. There is enormous amount of information in all these texts, and I think India was the first to explore the knowledge possibilities. Right from 5,000 years, we have got the history from 5,000 years. It may be in the field of food technology, it may be in the field of psychology, it may be in the field of chemistry, or it may be in the field of mathematics, it may be in the field of astronomy. Enormous amount of work has been done. But one important thing which is afflicting us is the Macaulay's education system. Vivekananda, who mentioned about the Macaulay's influence or the impact of Macaulay's education system on India, very clearly stated once, as soon as a student enters into a college, the first thing he learns is his father is a fool. The next thing he learns is his grandfather is an idiot. Nowadays, we mention it in a different way. Oh, there is the generation gap, that's what we call it. From my point of view, this generation gap should not be there. Because the realities are the same, whether it is for youngsters or for the elders. That generation gap should not be there. From that point of view, what we are expected to do is the question. As I told you, when I was churning the ocean of Indology, I call it Indian knowledge system rather than Indology, I came to the conclusion there is enormous amount of information which should be useful in the modern context also. Unless you make it relevant to the modern context, it is useless. Nobody will study. Why people do not study Sanskrit? Because even without studying, they can manage themselves and they can eke out their livelihood. Why people do not study Vedanta? Even without studying Vedanta, I can lead a very good life. So from that point of view, what we have to say is, it is very much relevant to your day-to-day life. That's what we have to show. If that is shown, then I think we can do something. From that point of view, I did a lot of research work. For the last 50 years, I am involved and indulging in the churning of Indology. And enormous amount of information was available to me, which is very much useful to the modern world. From that point of view, I want to show this one. I have got 6 volumes like this. This is a software program which I have printed here. That is the detailed bibliography of important manuscripts available on science and technology in India. I have listed about 8,500 palm leaf manuscripts dealing with various topics of science, nearly 40 domains of science. Unfortunately, our own scholars and our own scientists, our own mathematicians have not bothered to look into these manuscripts. I say I have listed only 8,500 manuscripts. According to me, this is the tip of the iceberg only. If I had enough of funds, I would have listed more than 1 lakh manuscripts dealing with science and technology in India, which have not been looked into by any of our scientists and mathematicians. Very important point is, they don't know even the names of these manuscripts. Only the names of the manuscripts are given here, and the metadata of the manuscript is given here. For example, in my program, if you search for the manuscript, manuscripts on anatomy, then 2 manuscripts are shown there, only 2 I have put there. One is called Shastrachedana Vidya, Sharirachedana Vidya. And this manuscript is available in the manuscript library in Srinagar. And I can give you all the details, where it can be, how you can approach those people, what is the phone number, etc. All the metadata is also given in that software program. So from that point of view, first and foremost thing is, we must assess what exactly is available in India even today. And how many manuscripts are available on sciences, technology, etc., etc. So this is a very important area for working. I told Dr. Pandurangi when he invited me for the talk, I said, most of the people come there, and most of the times what happens, these conferences are held, and as soon as the conference is over, people will forget about it. Will there be any follow-up action? My father used to say, Akashe utpanna shabdaha akashe viliyate, that's what he used to say. So nothing happens. But as soon as the conference is over, we must have some follow-up action and ultimately say, yes, these are the things to be done, focus on certain projects and ultimately take forward those projects. This is one of such important projects. Nearly 40 domains of science have been studied, and I have listed about 8,500 palm leaf manuscripts which are dealing with these 40 domains of science. Probably we can get more than 1 lakh manuscripts dealing with science and technology only. And another important thing, when we study about the Shastras, and Dr. Nayak is here and also Dr. Govindarajan is here, who are struggling very hard, but they are not recognized anywhere. To understand the perception from the point of view of Indian systems of philosophy. Very interesting thing is, I was mentioning in some other conference, we are depending upon the theory of perception which is advocated by the Greeks. Whatever Plato stated, that theory of perception we have. That theory of perception is called a representation theory. P. N. Srinivasacharya, in one of his works, namely Philosophy of Vishishtadvaita, mentions about perception, the story of perception as told by the Indians, not as told by the Westerners. All of you are so much conversant with the physics, you are conversant with neurosciences and neurolinguistics, etc. From the point of view of physics, how the perception takes place? The image of the object falls on my retina. Then I see the object. This is the story given by the physicist. Then the neurologist comes in and he says, certain electrical impulses are created in your brain, there, and then it will be carried to the brain, and certain neurons are fired in the brain. And then you can see the object. Then the psychologist has to come and he has to say, no, you can't see the original object completely, because when I am seeing this table, I can see only 3 legs, not 4 legs. The mind reconstructs the table again, and according to that you say the table has 4 legs and it is having such and such a shape, etc. The other side is not seen by me, no. So this is the theory of representation. Just imagine, this particular theory of representation is made use of in fMRI and also PET scan. What happens to you if it is a wrong theory? I am not going into philosophy or anything. On the other hand, from our point of view, what happens? The perception starts from the subject to the object. The consciousness flows through the manas, sense organs, and ultimately reaches those objects, and then it will be shaped in that particular way. Atma manasa sanyujyate, mana indriyena, indriyam arthena, tatah pratyaksha. If this theory is correct, should we design all our instruments like fMRI, MRI, and also PET scan, etc., based on this theory or on the theory of representation, which is piecemeal and which is incomplete? According to Plato and Aristotle, you can never see the original object. You are connected with the image of the object, not with the original object. But from our point of view, your consciousness is connected with the original object and it takes that particular shape. That's why Vachaspati Mishra, in his works, very clearly says, Samvideva hi bhagavati naha vastu upagame sharanam. Samvideva hi bhagavati naha vastu upagame sharanam. If you want to accept objects in this world, we must have this consciousness. This consciousness flows out and ultimately takes the form of those objects. That's why we have got the direct cognition of the object. According to Plato's theory or the representation theory, you don't have the direct cognition of the object, you have got the direct cognition of the image of the object only. By seeing a photo, can you say, I am seeing the original person here? This is a very important thing to be noted. And I think Chittaranjan Nayak and also Govindarajan, both of them are studying this for the last 2 years very seriously. Unfortunately, most of our scholars are not interested in these studies. Probably they will not read what they are writing. He has written several 100 pages with regard to that perception already. So we must be very serious scholars. In those days, it used to be said, Ekasmin janmani ekameva shastram. Now, Dr. Mishraji told us that we have to understand ourselves, understand our own philosophy, etc. So to understand one particular shastra, how much time does it require? It requires 60 years or 70 years of rigorous struggle, and you have to study for all the 18 hours, not 24 hours you can't study, at least 18 hours you have to study. I had several people, Rangnath Brahmatantra Parakal Swami of Mysore, and so many other scholars who used to think about the shastras almost all the time whenever they are awake. So eating, etc., some incidental, it becomes gramam gachanna trinam sprishati, just like that. So such deep involvement is necessary in Indology. I don't call it Indology. I want to call it Indian knowledge systems, which are most valuable. Another important point I want to mention about the worldly things is, when you are looking into these ancient texts, please try to extract all information that is available with regard to science and technology, which will be most useful. Whether you like it or not, our modern religion is science is the religion. Am I right or wrong? If it is proved by science, you say, oh, it is accepted. If it is not proved by science, you will not accept it. And whatever science is, whether you examine it or not, you simply accept it because it is stated or it is validated by science. I am not saying that our ancient knowledge systems should be validated by means of science only. You can use science also as a medium to understand our ancient knowledge systems, because they need not be validated again, because our great rishis and great sages have validated all those things, not only by means of perception, by means of inference, by means of intuition also. Intuition is a very, very important point when you understand. Hella, sorry. Okay. And I'll mention that point also. Okay. So from that point of view, what are you expect to do? So this is one of the things which I have done. This is Science and Technology in India Through the Ages, which was published by me nearly 5 or 6 in 2004 when I was in the Academy of Sanskrit Research. Dr. Kastur Rangan, who is considered to be one of the greatest scientists of India, he says this is one of the best books I have ever seen. And he also said, I get so much of inspiration from this particular book. And when he was in the ISRO, when he was the chairman of the ISRO, he actually financed this particular project and this book was brought out. So you can go through that leisurely. But my feeling is we should not revel in past glory. Can we do something now? So from that point of view, also I have done some sort of research work. According to me, whether it is religion or whether it is philosophy or any text, let it be, wherever you touch, you can get some information for research work. One important thing I want to mention. I was studying the works of Ramanuja. One of them is called Nitya Grantha, in which he says how you are expected to worship the God. All the puja vidhanas have been given in detail. In that he says there are 5 cups kept for offering, Argya, Padya, Achamaniya, etc. For this Naniya cup, he says you have to put the vettivair or the Lamanchanta Karitara in English, Kannadadali. It's called vettivair. That vettivair has to be put into the water. It gives a fine fragrance to the water, etc. I am working in one of the colleges, namely Venkateshwara Engineering College in Bangalore, as a senior mentor. And we took up some research work on this subject also under the Department of Civil Engineering. We said, what is the effect of vetiver on water? When we studied, very interesting thing that happened was it will clean the fluoride from water. We artificially introduced 10 units of water, 10 units of fluoride into the water. Then pass the water through vetiver, 100 grams of vetiver. Every day we used to pass 10 liters of water through 100 grams. And the fluoride content comes down to 0.5%, but 1.5% is the admissible amount. Is it not a good research work? And now so many people are suffering, particularly our own politicians. They may not be interested in these things, because if you give small solutions, simple solutions, if they can solve it, they cannot have big projects, you know. Why they want to have big projects, you understand that. I don't want to mention that. It should be several crore project. It may be several rupees project actually. Such research works can also be done. That's what I'm telling. There is so much of scope for Indology to do research work, because our predecessors have showered so much of information on you. Because you are flooded with information, you will not be able to do anything because you are in the woods. That's my feeling. Similarly, in the same manner, last time when I met Dr. Pandurangi, I was telling him, when we are actually pronouncing the Vedas or chanting the Vedas, some small drops of saliva will also come out. It is called Brahma Bindu in Manusmriti. Is it really Brahma Bindu? It is sacred actually, that's what they say. Otherwise, when you are actually speaking, if the saliva, drops of saliva come out, then it is not considered to be auspicious or it is good. Probably what happens, lot of research work has to be done with regard to this also. When you are actually chanting the Vedas, the organization of the sounds are very important. That's why Mimamsakas always advocate Anupurvi Nityatva. It should be studied in that sequence. Okay. Agnimi Ile Purohitam, Yajnasya Deva Mrityujam. You cannot say Yajnasya Deva Mrityujam, Agnimi Ile Purohitam. The same Anupurvi has to be continued. If the same Anupurvi has to be maintained, why? Then can we convert that into signals? And see, what is the combination, how the wave patterns appear, etc. All these things have to be studied. In addition to that, very important thing to be noted is that everything is permutation and combination of letters only. Whether it is Vishnu Sahasranama or Vedas or some nonsense, some text which is written by a Nastika, Charvaka text, let it be. But why this is considered to be sacred and why they are not considered to be sacred? From that point of view, what you have to study is when these sounds are organized in a particular way, where the tongue touches the different parts of the vocal organ in your body, in your mouth. So it is actually acupressure given to those parts. Then what happens? Certain neurons are fired in your brain, and then there is so much of impact of that on the brain, and you can get rid of so many diseases also. Yesterday, Dr. Another person from Pune or somebody, he was mentioning about how the hypertension can be removed by chanting certain mantras, etc., etc. So in that way, what sort of acupressure is done while we are chanting these mantras in a specific order? That's a very important thing. There is a lot of scope for research work. And another thing is, while we are doing research, particularly with regard to the efficacy of the mantras, foreigners have done so much of work. For example, Professor Emoto in Japan, he has done a lot of research work. And he has used very simple devices, and he says love before water, and after that he crystallizes that particular water. The crystallization takes place and the crystal appears to be very beautiful, the formation of the crystal. Then he uses the word hatred. Then water absorbs that and the crystal is in such a distorted way it is formed and it is not good. There is so much of disturbance. In that way, crystallography is one of the important subjects to test the efficacy of the mantras on water. They have created 1 lakh databases using crystallography, and unfortunately no Indian is interested in this particular research work because water has got such a remarkable memory. Go to Pondicherry. In Pondicherry they are doing some more research work, that also you can see. They don't give you, they not only give you good water for drinking, pure water for drinking, they also energize it by means of mantras and also by means of music. They play Western music to energize the water, and they also play certain mantras to energize the water. So what happens, the water is more useful and at the same time it will be helpful to improve your health. And actually all the vibrations come back from water, that can be seen. And all the Brahmins who are associated here, who are assembled here, know about the Udakshanti mantras. Have we tried anything in that? When I chant the Udakshanti mantras, what ions are charged and how the crystal is formed, have we done any research work? For all these things, ultimately money is very much required. When you go to Government of India or when you go to some other Department of Science and Technology, they look at me like this, oh, you are doing some research work on science. You are having Namam and you are having Yajnopavitam, etc. What can you do? You are a Sanskrit Pandit. Can you do something? Can we allot 5 crores or 7 crores for you? If it is a research, science research organization, I can give you 1 crore or 10 crores also. That's a brick problem. I'll not go into those details now. In that way, enormous amount of scope is there to do research work even in worldly things. This is what I wanted to say. Then next thing is, think of philosophy. How many people are doing research work on consciousness in India? Have we not spoken about consciousness for the last several years, several thousand years? And our research work actually starts from the subject to the object, whereas Western research work starts from object to the subject. Slowly they are recognizing, physicists are recognizing the presence of consciousness in particles. So if you see thermodynamics, they say, yes, we see something like consciousness. They were speaking of consciousness was a taboo for physicists, just like for Dr. Rajaramanna, E.C.G. Sudarshan, etc. I organized a conference in which they spoke, and they were very free to speak about consciousness. Yes, we find some consciousness even in the atoms. That's what they said. So we have got enormous amount of information on consciousness, whether it is Nyaya Vaisheshika system or the Sankhya Yoga system or the Uttaramimamsa and Purvamimamsa system. Enormous amount of information is available on consciousness. What research work have we done? Have we designed any experiments? And with regard to Indian psychology, we know nothing. There is enormous amount of information about psychology also. Are we interested in these things? Do we conduct conferences just for the sake of conferences and be done with it? Should we not have follow-up action? Should we not do something? In addition to that, one more thing I wanted to mention, which was reminded by Dr. Pandurangi. There are so many Western people who are indulging in the study of Indology, or who are churning Indology with a different perspective. According to me, because their perspective is not perfect, it is not good. It is not with good intention. They are rewarded by hala hala only, not with ambrosia. That is my feeling anyway. People like Wendy Doniger, yesterday I received some paper about Wendy Doniger, which deals about the Aryan invasion theory, etc., etc. So much of misinterpretation is done. And all those people, all the Westerners, are interested in the time frame of the Vedas, when it was written, who wrote it. According to us, nobody wrote it. And when it was written, it was eternal, so it was not written at any time. Now, when you are taking a banana, when it is a ripe banana, should we discuss about the skin of the banana, or should we actually take the kernel and eat it and enjoy it? That's what I want to say. With regard to this, I want to mention one important point. Bharadwaja Vaimanika Shastra was one of the important subjects, and it was published by G.R. Joshiar, who was my maternal uncle. When it was given to Indian Institute of Science, many of the great scientists who are good Sanskrit scholars also, they said this is all nonsense. So it has to be thrown into the gutters, because nobody can use a heavy metal like Padarasam or Mercury and fly an aircraft. Go to the internet and find out how many Mercury vortex engines have been experimented in the West. Recently, one particular scientist in MIT has done research work, and he has adopted the shape of a particular vimana, Tripura vimana or some such thing. And when he moves it through the wind tunnel, he says this is the best model having full aerodynamics. It is done according to aerodynamics. I find it so much useful. So that's why I say, when we go into these texts, these people who are in the Indian Institute of Science, they said, oh, this Bharadwaja Vaimanika Shastra does not belong to 1500 century or some thing. And it was written by Anekal Subrahi Shastri, as revealed to Anekal Subrahi Shastri. So it is a modern text. So we don't want to go into the details. First, there is so much of prejudice like this. I am not very much bothered about the time frame of any individual text. On the other hand, what it contains is more important for me. From that point of view, can you do something? If it is a valuable information, suppose yesterday somebody has done it, why I should not take it? So the scientists in the Indian Institute of Science were not bothered about these things, and ultimately they discarded it. But particularly in NASA and particularly in Germany, they are trying again and again, and I think they have evolved so many things which are very important. So in that way, when we actually go into the older texts, particularly on different systems of philosophy, and enormous amount of information is available, not only with regard to Prakriti, with regard to Purusha and also Paramatma also. According to me, any scientist, yesterday there was a discussion about that also. Any person cannot do away with science because you have got a physical body. You have to obey all the natural laws as if you want to preserve the physical body. But at the same time, you are endowed with a spiritual thing, namely your consciousness. Can you neglect it? So from that point of view, your Indology can go in both the ways. Indological studies have to be churned, or Indology has to be churned for different purposes, for the physical results and also spiritual results. For spiritual results, one more important point I want to mention. Dr. Mishraji was mentioning about one important point about the misinterpretation of Bhagavad Gita. Long, long ago it has been stated in our shastras, Bibheti alpashrutadvedaha mamayam pratarishyati. Because we are all alpashrutas in a way. So we should be very careful when we are interpreting older texts. So while we are interpreting, we also require a sort of intuition, otherwise it is impossible. Recently when I was teaching Yamanacharya Stotratna to somebody, I came across a very important point. Swadayanya sarvesham trayantartham sudurgraham stotrayamasa yogindraha tambande yamunakvayam. It is very difficult to interpret the Vedas. In Tamil we say it is marai. It means it conceals everything. It will not give you all the information. This is very important from the point of view of N.T. Doniger and others also. Because with a different perspective you have to approach the Upanishads, Brahma Sutras, Bhagavad Gita, etc. Dr. D.V. Gundappa, who was one of the outstanding thinkers of our India and also of Karnataka, he has written a beautiful introduction to Ishavasyopanishad. Ishavasyopanishad consists of 18 shlokas only, not more than that. So while you are studying this Ishavasyopanishad, with what perspective you have to approach that? He mentions about the Western approach also. When you give the text to a particular person, he will go through dictionary, he will split the words, get the meaning of all the words, etc., etc., and then he will say, this is the text and how many variations are there, when it might have been written, all these things he will do. But the holistic approach is not there. When we study Ishavasyopanishad, what will be our feeling? Whether we have Shraddha in that or not? I am not simply dissecting the Ishavasyopanishad and trying to understand that. On the other hand, with what perspective it has been stated? When we try to understand that, then what happens? We get different results altogether. So he says, with so much of reverence and respect, you have to approach Ishavasyopanishad. Then the Ishavasyopanishad will reveal to you so many interesting things which a foreigner cannot find out, just because he is depending upon dictionaries. My acharya used to say, nowadays we have got different types of pundits. Some of them are catalog pundits. Some of them are dictionary pundits. Some of them are pundits of encyclopedia. So that is how they approach. Our approach is totally different. We have got a holistic approach in what context this has been stated and what they want to communicate ultimately. Words are not very, very much important. Particularly in Nyaya Shastra, we say, the tatparyartha is more important than the padapadartha. So from that point of view, can we get more and more information in these ancient shastras? Definitely we can get it, provided you have shraddha, you have bhakti, and at the same time you approach it with a sort of intuition, praying to the great sages and saints who have given us this valuable information. So from this, in this way, what happens, enormous amount of work can be done. One or two more points I'll mention, and I'll show you what I have done so far. I am trying to do one interesting thing. When I am saying I am not scolding, or I am not bringing down the image of Western science, technology, etc., etc., I think they are in the physical field. Particularly Westerners are just like Rakshasas, according to me, or just like Ravana. They can do sadhana very well. By means of sadhana, they can also put everything in proper way. That means their, documentation skills are very, very good. Unfortunately, we don't have such documentation skills, because mostly we depend upon intuition. And we belong to Shruti Parampara rather than Lekhana Parampara. Shrauta Parampara we belong. With regard to that, a lot of things have to be stated. So can we use those things for the development of Indian sciences and in the Indian philosophy, Indian psychology, etc.? That's what I am trying to do. All the sciences and technology should subserve the purpose of Indian sciences and technology and spirituality. This is what I am trying to do. I have used some of the technologies for that particular purpose only. It should subserve the purpose of Indian knowledge systems. That's a very important point. And another important point is, I am also batting for indigenous, eco-friendly, not ego-friendly, science and technology. Indigenous, eco-friendly, cost-effective, simple science and technology. So this book is a result of that only. Because several problems which have been solved by the Westerners can be easily solved by the Easterners in a different manner. One important thing I will mention. I was studying about civil engineering in India. I have prepared several PowerPoint presentations on civil engineering, mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, floriculture, mnemonics, and so many other things. You can see all those things. I don't know whether I'll be able to show all those things to you now. It takes nearly several days to go through all those things. Very valuable. Particularly mechanical engineering. People say, did they know all these things? I said, they knew all those things. You don't know that they knew. That's what I want to tell. So from that point of view, what happens? Very simple solutions are given. Suppose you have to write on a stone. Is it not very difficult to carve? They have to have a chisel and hit it, etc. So many things they have to do. Very simple solution they have given. Two herbs they have identified. Take the juice from those two herbs, mix them equally, and then smear it on the stone. It becomes soft. Write it. Next day it becomes hard again. Is this not a simple solution? In that way, several simple solutions are available for many of the modern problems also. When you go through our text. That's why I said about the fluoride removal. Simply lamancha you put, or vetiver you put, and it will remove. In those days they used to put vetiver into the water, and then they drink it. They used to drink it. But now you don't know it is cleaning the fluoride from the water. That's why you are suffering. So in that way, so much of work can be done. I have prepared a PowerPoint presentation. If you can go through that, I'll come there and also show it to you. Yeah? This one is. Huh? Okay. I thought. Nanda yarad nimisha mugis. A torsputtenu sonna. I am extremely thankful to you for giving me an opportunity. I am also thankful to all the audience, because they have listened to my lecture with pin drop silence. My humble request is, try to explore something and you will be amply rewarded. Don't leave it at this. Thank you very much. Namaste.